Hi, I'm Pragya Gulati and I lead marketing at HT Smartcast. Welcome to this exclusive series, HT Smartcast Leadership Lessons. So I'm going to be talking to leaders across industries, their journeys, their aspirations, their challenges, and how they overcame them. And this is an HT Smartcast original from HT Smartcast, which is India's fastest producing podcast platform. So for my first episode, I have with me Nitish Sarda. Welcome, Nitish, who's the founder of SmartWorks, which is India's largest agile workspace provider to enterprises. So prior to SmartWorks, Nitish has also worked with Vision Comtech Integrators Limited, where he was heading business development. And he's also had experience with two major real estate providers, including Space Group and PS Group in the past. So how are you doing?
Very well. How are you?
I'm good too. Thank you for joining. So just to begin with, tell me about SmartWorks. Like, how did this idea come into play?
So, you know, we thought about SmartWorks almost 3.5 years back. I had just come back from college. I was studying in America, and then after that had shifted to Singapore and then came back to India in mid-2016. And you know, when I was still in America and in Singapore, we were doing our campus visits. We saw that offices in the West had evolved a lot, right? People, it was not just a workspace with workstations and chairs. The millennials there started demanding much more in their office spaces, and they wanted their spaces to provide more services to them. That is when I came back to India and I started going to my father's office. I realized that there is a distinct, you know, big difference when it comes to the kind of environment and ecosystem that's created, you know, in a Google office or in a Microsoft office or LinkedIn office in the West compared to what we're able to provide here in India. And I thought that is a gap that we really need to bridge. And you know, commercial real estate in India has seen limited innovation in the past 10 decades. Most of the business is basically building out properties and then leasing it out to clients. But just understanding what the employees really want, what kind of services can be added into the seat cost and provided, that is where we thought there's an opportunity in the market. And that is how we came up with the concept of SmartWorks. We're categorized as a co-working space, but we're more of an agile office player. Co-working was the... Everyone was talking about co-working at that point of time. That's why we thought that was the right market to get into. But as a product, we've differentiated ourselves and are focused towards providing customized workspaces and an office experience company rather than just a co-working player. And that's why our target market has also been very different. We're not really a typical co-working player that goes with a lot of startups or people who are looking at, you know, shorter term deals with 10 to 15 seats per customer. We're actually going after enterprises with 95% plus of our 400 plus enterprises being customers being enterprises. And the average seat count per customer is more than 400 seats. So we're looking at enterprises as our clientele.
All right. And in just 3-4 years, you know, SmartWorks has actually managed to be profitable. And I'm sure this journey that you were just mentioning would have been full of challenges, full of ups and downs. So can you throw some light on that? Like, what challenges did you face? How did you overcome them?
I think profitability is one of the things that has always been on the top of our heads. We've been very focused on growing the business, but growing it profitably. For us, the business thesis was for any business to be really successful, 2 years is proof of concept. 2 years is where you see that, you know, we're going to acquire a market, and that's the time it takes for a business to get established. But from the third year, it needs to show profitability. And that's what we've been very, very focused on. Obviously, during this entire journey, every entrepreneur, every business has its share of mistakes that it made. For us, I think some of the challenges that we faced upfront was, we were trying to perfect the model, right? What I've learned really is that there is no perfect model. It is very important for you to launch your POC, your first product out, and then keep improvising and learning on that product and improving that product with the customer feedback that you get, rather than going ahead and trying to develop a product which according to you is the best the best in the market, right? So for us, that is one thing that I think we were one of the mistakes that we'd made earlier. And obviously the other challenge, the biggest challenge that we faced was we were trying to create a category in the business, right? As I said earlier, commercial real estate in India has seen limited innovation. It's basically been builders building out buildings and leasing it out to customers. We were trying to create another category in which we're adding a layer of services onto what we offer to our customers. When we were doing that initially, we were changing how people look at commercial real estate, right? People usually think of it on a per square foot model, that I'm taking out 10,000 square foot and I'm going to make 100 people sit there. We changed that concept and said that instead of taking up on square foot, why don't you start paying on per seat model, right? And I'm going to bake in a lot of your operational costs within those seat pricing itself. So I think just that change in concept was a challenge that was there. But I think we've picked up quite a lot. Co-working in general has become more accepted in the market, not just with smaller companies or companies who are growing and startups, but also with enterprises now accepting us as an alternative to traditional office spaces.
Yeah, all right. So since like your journey has been of about 3-4 years, and within this year, we've seen like this giant COVID-19 black swan event, which has locked all of us in our houses and, you know, everyone is clueless. So, of course, you were going in a certain direction, and I'm sure this event would have changed that direction for you, right? So, how did this happen? And then now, what is your vision going forward?
No, I think, obviously, what COVID is significantly impacted growth of companies. I won't say it has impacted everyone economically, but it's definitely impacted growth. For us, we were trajectorying. We've been growing at 25 to 30% month on month for the past 3 years, right? That growth rate had been significantly high. And we kept acquiring new and new more properties and more customers in a short lifespan of 3 years. Obviously, we were projecting to go and aggressively keep following that number. What COVID has really done is put a halt on expansion for us because of the foundation of the business being very solid, which was always our focus. We haven't seen a significant impact on the business economically, but obviously the growth trajectory, which was at a 25 to 30% growth month on month, that has gone down slightly, and we are seeing a period of 2-3 months in which decision making all throughout in all industries have slowed down significantly. People are waiting and watching for how things are going to turn out post-COVID era. And because of that, business growth has stopped. But I think this is a very good opportunity for a lot of us young entrepreneurs, startups, to understand and set the foundations to be right. So that in the future, if there are any downturns, economical situations in which you're not being able to demand the same margins, the foundation of the business should be strong enough for you to survive these downtimes as well.
Absolutely. I think foundation is really, really important. And to me personally, I think people actually form a very strong part of that foundation which you're referring to. And I was reading about SmartWorks, and I was reading that there were some 20 plus employees in 2016. And now you have like a huge workforce of 300 plus. So is there any leadership mantra that you follow so that, you know, you keep that team intact, or what do you do? I mean, how do you manage this huge workforce?
I think we've grown significantly. Obviously, we've grown from a 20 member to a 300 member, as you rightly said. Two things that we've done very successfully is empower, departmental heads. We've divided the companies into 5 or 6 different departments, which individually handle each and every portion of a customer's journey. For example, if a customer's being onboarded, before that you have the sales team, our execution team, which is focusing on how do you portray SmartWorks before the customer joins the ecosystem. Then we have an entire community team and operation team, which basically takes the customer through the journey when they're spending their time in SmartWorks. And then we have our other teams, which is technology, which is our marketing team, which basically enhances your experience within SmartWorks. So one thing that's worked very well for us is actually dividing those departments and then empowering those people, those individuals who are heading those departments to take their own decisions, have their own teams, look at that division as something which they have the liberty to learn, because that is the only way we'll be able to scale, right? We started off with three centers in our first year with only 50,000 square foot in one city. We're there in 9 cities today, covering a footprint of 4.2 million square foot, having more than 70,000 desks within our ecosystem. Managing that requires a lot of teams to coordinate with each other and within themselves. So empowering your managers to take decisions and doing your constant review, right? For us, one mantra that we follow internally is making mistakes is not a problem, right? Everyone does that. I have made my share of mistakes growing SmartWorks. But making sure that you realize when you've made your mistake and not repeating it. That is the biggest lesson that as a leader, we want to push. And I think the other bit is to keep everyone in the company motivated. You know, it's very important for you to communicate, not with just your top leadership, but also with everyone, because this needs to be a very top-down approach in which the messaging needs to go out from the leadership, in which you're informing your people on where do you see yourself go in the next 2 years and how do you see the company grow. If the people are motivated, they have enough in them to make sure that whatever goals the company sets out, they keep achieving it whenever they are supposed to.
Yeah, I agree with you. It's very important to keep people motivated, true. But then I think you can actually motivate people only when you yourself are motivated enough, right? So do you do something like at a personal level? Do you meditate or do you do some other exercise or anything of that sort which you'd like to share just to keep yourself motivated?
I think one of the habits that I really have or I'm developing more on it is the fact that I like to meditate. My meditation is a little different. It's not a traditional meditation. I like to spend a little bit of time after every day of work, 10-15 minutes, just reviewing my day, understanding what are the things that happened, where are the things that, what are the things that I did, how much time did I dedicate on a certain thing, and planning out my next day. As well, just spending that time really helps you get an idea of how your day is progressing and what are some of the things that you need to prioritize. The second thing that I really like to focus on is basically reading about a lot of people who've been successful in their lives, right? Because I am a big follower of learning from others' mistakes. If I can read about someone, see their journey and see where they made mistakes and how they overcome it. And that doesn't make me do those same mistakes. I think it's a great thing for everyone to do, right? So just learning about others, how have they tackled some of the challenges, because a lot of these challenges, if I've already not faced them, I might face them in the near future. So just, understanding and learning from others' experiences also something that I like to focus on.
Yeah, so do you recommend a specific book which you've read and has helped you? Or do you have a role model in mind whom you want to emulate? Is there anything of that sort?
So there's no ideal person. There's not one person that I really idealize and this is who I want to become. I think you always run from successes and failures of every great leader. Right, whether it is someone like Warren Buffett or Steve Jobs or Bill Gates, all of them have made fair share of mistakes growing up, right, and growing their businesses. I think it is very important for you to learn from their journeys, see how they've been, their decision-making has been so quick. They've not been afraid to, take really risky steps with their businesses and have that risk-taking appetite. I think that's very important for any entrepreneur. You really need to, if you really want to be rewarded, you need to take those risks. So there's not one person that I really idolize. I think it's a mix of all. There's a lot that you can learn from different personalities who've done so well in their personal lives as well as professional lives.
Yeah, and my second question was, do you have like a book which you'd like to recommend to, let's say, entrepreneurs who are just starting off? Is there anything of that sort?
I think there are a lot of leadership books that definitely help you. My personal favorite is, I'm a big believer of Chanakya Niti. It is a little Indianized version of how today's corporate world should look. But Corporate Chanakya is one of the books that I always refer back to. Whenever I have certain challenges in the business and I want to see on how to overcome it, that's one book that I always refer back to.
Lovely. And let's say if somebody were to ask you for an advice, if that person wants to just enter this co-working space as a startup or build his own brand, do you have any advice for such people?
Absolutely. No, I think, for us, co-working is just one of the segments. There are more than 400 co-working players already in India, but then there are other divisions like co-living. Then there is other set of prop tech companies which are also making significant inroads into the market, right? So I think one of my advisors would be, one, try to focus on a niche, right? What has been really successful for us is not going after everything that is working, just focusing on who your target market is eventually going to be, and making sure that you cater or you customize your product in such a way that it really focuses on that market and you become a leader in that segment. Co-working is very broad. It's divided into multiple segments internally, in which there is a set of co-working which focuses on startups and SMEs, which also does very, very well. Then there is a set of co-working which focuses on short-term requirements and prefab offices, which also does very well. And then there is us, who focus on enterprises and who focus on larger requirements and completely custom-made solutions for our clients. That is a division that does very well for us. So I think it's very important for you to be very clear in your head which is the niche market that you want to go with, A. And B is obviously profitability is very, very important. Whenever you start off a business, there is only so much time that you can give the business to grow and burn. But if you really want to establish a successful business that has a very strong foundation, profitability is number one. You really need to prioritize profitability. Yeah.
So I actually got reminded of one of my brand management lectures when I was doing my MBA. So one of my profs used to say this, that if you try to become everything for everyone, you'll end up becoming nothing for no one. And that's exactly what you are alluding to, right? You have your niche, you decide who your target audience is, and then go after it. Okay, so Nitish, my last question to you is, like, what is your outlook for this industry in the post-COVID era?
So we are very optimistic on what the outcome is going to be. Obviously, we've seen a slight delay in business, delay in the growth, as I alluded to earlier. But I think, once people start coming back to work, commercial real estate has been very, very strong in India for a very long time. We've had almost 42 million square foot of office space being absorbed year on year. And I think for our segment, we've seen significant spike in inquiries that have started coming into the market. On a day-to-day basis, on a monthly basis, we used to get close to about 4,000 to 5,000 seats of inquiries every month. That number has spiked up to almost 40 to 50,000 seats of inquiries every month. So there is a 10x growth in inquiry, which is a very positive outcome. It means that people are accepting this as a better alternative than traditional office spaces, or if not better, at least equal to traditional office spaces. We are very optimistic on our end that for co-working in general, for all segments of co-working, post-COVID is going to be the curve upward is going to be much more steeper than what it was. So far.
Wow, that's so fantastic. Thank you so much, Nitish, for joining me. I wish SmartWorks scales newer and newer heights. And I wish you also all the best in your journey.
Thank you so much, Pragya.
Thank you. So if you have any feedback or would like to feature on HT Smartcast Leadership Lessons, please write to me on LinkedIn. You can also write to us at @HTSmartcast across various social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, LinkedIn, and Instagram. And this video series will also be available as a podcast on htsmartcast.com. Thank you.